Good morning, everybody. Happy Wednesday. We still have an amazing show for everybody today. And Ryan is still filling in for Crystal. Thank you, Ryan.
Amazing to be here.
It's always amazing over here. All right, we've got Daniel Marin's in the show. He's going to talk a little bit about Jamal Bowman in that race. And I've got the Trump campaign on. I'm going to press them a little bit on things ain't going so well, you might want to say. However, we're going to start off with something that we gave you a little bit of an update before the numbers came in yesterday. And that is what happened in the state of Kentucky in that primary between progressive Charles Booker and establishment Amy McGrath. So, Ryan, tell us what happened here. Charles Booker coming unbelievably close to Amy McGrath there. However, as I understand it, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is that her mail-in ballot game was just so strong before the protest movement happened that despite Charles winning overwhelming amounts of votes on Election Day, that she was able to pull it off because of all of the out-of-state money that was poured into her coffers by Chuck Schumer.
Right. So the conventional wisdom on this is only half right at this point. So the conventional wisdom says, and I spread some of this conventional wisdom, mm-hmm. but I always try to clarify it with the other half of it, which is that Booker's surge came late in the primary.
Right.
But that and her collapse came late in the primary. But that alone does not explain everything that happened. Mm-hmm. The gap comes in because she had millions of dollars to spend on this mail chase program, which allowed her campaign to model all across the state who their supporters were, identify them by name and address and phone number, and reach out to them by mail and by phone and by text in an individual way. Because if you have $40+ million to spend on a primary, you can do that. They mailed something like a 70+ page colored economic treatise. Mm-hmm. I don't think it had a lot of specifics about what her economic policy was. It was like a 70-page mailer to everyone in the state. So that's a campaign that is trying to figure out ways to burn money.
Yes.
And one of the better ways to burn money is to just constantly be doing voter contacts. And so when the window opened to do early voting, June 8th, mm-hmm. her campaign just blasted to everybody that they had at their disposal, hey, it's time to vote. Don't you hate what Mitch McConnell did to Merrick Garland? Get your ballot in now and stick it to Mitch. And so all of these people who were hearing from this Democratic candidate said, yeah, I do want to stick it to Mitch. And I'm going to vote against him as early as possible. That's like June 8th. So she gets a ton of mail in. So, yes, she was in the lead at that point. Mm-hmm. But if she didn't have that hugely funded mail program, a lot of those people would have eventually voted. But they would have waited a few days, and it was in the days after that the media started covering Booker's campaign, that the protests gathered more steam, that McGrath had her terrible debate moments that started circulating more, mm-hmm. and he overtakes her. Now, the other thing you saw is the spoiler. Now,
Mike Breuer, who we also had on the show.
Right. Was he a spoiler or not? Okay. It's an interesting question. Mm. Who is he drawing votes from in the early stages? Mm-hmm. Now, it may be because he campaigned so heavily in rural Kentucky that he actually pulled a significant number of votes away
from Amy McGrath.
From Amy McGrath in the beginning. But the fact that when it was obvious that he wasn't the one that was going to break out, mm-hmm. that he didn't get out and endorse Booker, probably cost Booker a point or two. Like there was a point or two that he could have.
Right. But it's a 3-point margin. I mean, I think the real thing that we can look at this is the problem, honestly, with mail-in balloting, and I'm not saying I'm against mail-in balloting, but when you're starting to vote a month before Election Day, things change. Remember, I mean, during October 2016, the Comey letter, that came like, 10 days before the election? Some people probably changed their votes based upon that letter. So if they had voted before, their vote was already banked. I just think it's interesting, and it's not, I mean, it was very not beneficial to Charles because on Election Day, and you I think you have some of the numbers on this, he won overwhelmingly on Election Day amongst those ballots that were cast. He had the media on his side, the protest movement, which he used in his final ad in order to bolster himself up, calling out McGrath for calling herself a pro-Trump Democrat. But I guess this is always just a lesson and something I say here all the time. Never underestimate the sheer amount of money that goes towards these people. How much money did she have in the bank when she was going after him?
More than $50 million.
That's insane.
She saved a bunch for the general election as well. And Facebook was just a well that she could continue to tap. Mm-hmm. Put up a photo of Mitch McConnell. Money just
beat Mitch.
Money just pours in. She was running ads nationally.
Of course, because right. Isn't most of your money from out of state? I don't even think
right, because you can only raise so much from small dollars. And so that's an interesting dimension of this new movement, of the small dollar movement, which as we see, cuts across ideological lines. Now, she also got tons of big money as well. But like Zephyr Teachout, for instance, who ran for, attorney general in New York, a ton of her money came from out of state because a ton came from New York, but a ton came from mostly California. Because if you're getting, $50 from, millions of Democrats, you have to go outside
of
your state.
Right.
And then it creates a liability back home. People say, look, this is just out of state money that's pouring into New York or pouring into Kentucky. But it raises an interesting question about the nature of an election day. Because I've actually always wondered, take Brexit, for instance.
Yes.
Whatever you think about the outcome, should the future, the entire course of a country's future be determined by whether or not it rains in London on a Tuesday or whatever day they held the election. So the virtue of mail is that, yes, it means that people's minds are going to change throughout that time. But on the other hand, they have a lot more time to think about it. They can and candidates ought to think of the first day that voting can possibly begin as election day. Like, we should stop referring to November as election day. We should say October.
You know who really understood this? The Sanders campaign. I remember Chuck Rocha on this show. He was hyper-focused on one thing, the day that mail-in ballots began in California, which was the same day as Iowa.
Right.
He was like, you know what? This is our primary day. He's like, as far as I can concern, and if I recall, I think Sanders won because of the mail-in ballots. So like,
That's actually right. And Biden would probably complain, because I think Biden actually won on election day in California, shockingly, absurdly, because of this massive swing in the suburbs toward him after the consolidation. So, you live by the sword, you die by the sword on the way that the structures.
Well, it's a good point, but I think that the broader narrative that's coming out of this, I mean, just to me, I'm an outside observer, is let's also throw up the results from Colorado, which is what we have here, where John Hickenlooper beat Andrew Romanoff 59.6 to 40.4. I mean, Andrew Romanoff, again, this is a progressive guy. We had him on the show many times. He actually won, he had all these state party chairmen who endorsed him. He won, I think, their convention, whatever. Yeah. It's a very complicated process, which he explained to me a couple times. But anyway, Andrew Romanoff seemed to have a groundswell of decent support, but it seems like the same story here, where the National Party picks John Hickenlooper and then really, I mean, just tries to prop him up as much as they possibly can. I mean, we covered here on the show Cory Booker and Elizabeth Warren jumping in to save Hickenlooper, really, against Romanoff after, you can explain it, but there's all these scandals. I think he said some problematic things in the past. And just broadly, he's in trouble against Cory Gardner. The Gardner campaign is doing backflips against John Hickenlooper. Mm-hmm. I was reading a story in Politico. They were like, this was supposed to be the most winnable Democratic seat in the entire Senate. And now Hickenlooper could put it in danger because Schumer's getting involved.
Yeah, that's right. And so, and the way that this unfolded, there was a huge, open competitive primary in which Romanoff would have been, one of the front runners, which was then completely disrupted when Schumer, relentlessly pushed Hickenlooper to jump into the race. Hickenlooper, as most people have forgotten, ran for president. believe it or not, that went terribly.
Yeah.
And he said, "Look, I don't want to be a senator because I'd be terrible at it." He said that on camera. It's nice of him to be honest.
Yes.
But Schumer talked him into it anyway, which raises this interesting question of why. Like the polls showed that a generic Democrat was going to perform extremely well against Cory Gardner.
Yes.
It's wrong to ever say anything is a lock, but if anybody was going to go down in 2020, it's Cory Gardner. He's almost a fluke.
Republicans even know that.
Right, senator who won in 2014 thanks to Syria getting overrun by ISIS and Ebola landing in Texas.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden he's a senator.
Yeah. He barely won, too.
Beat Mark Udall. And kind of a surprise upset. And he's a sunny guy, nice, smart guy, talented politician, but Colorado is trending strongly against him. So you don't really need to mess with that. Mm-hmm. Just let the voters pick the best candidate. Instead, Schumer insists on getting Hickenlooper in, so most people drop out. Because unlike Amy McGrath, Hickenlooper has a real base in Colorado.
He was a governor.
He was very, he was a popular governor. Yeah. He was a popular mayor of Denver. And, you know, despite his performance in the presidential election, a good politician back in Colorado. But he's very out of step with the current Democratic Party. People call him Fracking Looper.
Yes.
Because of his intense relationship with the fracking industry and fossil fuel industry generally around the world. And so you're not going to get the organized kind of climate youth who were behind Romanoff to then put energy into Hickenlooper. That's a huge problem in Colorado. Mm-hmm. That's not a small amount of energy that you could be tapping in Colorado. Now, Romanoff, you know, was not the most dynamic candidate. Really interesting guy, smart guy, earnest guy. He just didn't kind of strike the same chord as Booker, for instance, did. You know, sometimes you catch the national wave and sometimes you don't. You know, Tom Perriello didn't catch it when he was running for Virginia governor. Ed Markey hasn't really caught it, even, mm-hmm. you know, running for re-election in Massachusetts. Sometimes you can't tell
why that is. It's McConnell. It's just, McConnell is such a flashpoint that Kentucky, whoever, I mean, this is why McGrath is who she is. Because anybody who runs against McConnell, people are like, I mean, look, it's going to be like anybody who runs against Schumer, every Republican in the country is going to be like, oh, this is funny, right? Like, people will probably donate to AOC if she ran against Schumer just to see Schumer go down. That's how much they hate him. But at the same time, I wanted you to be able to update. There's two city council seats in Louisville. What happened there with the Democratic Socialists of America?
Well, the most fun race, Matt Jones mentioned this on Twitter this morning, sports radio host in Kentucky. In eastern Kentucky, there's a Republican Johnny Turner running against Democrat Johnny Ray Turner.
Okay.
It's like a state senate race in eastern Kentucky. But so we'll follow that one closely. Yeah. But so in Louisville, there were two DSA-backed candidates, a guy named Robert Bell, another one named Ryan Fenwick. And this is linked to the kind of movement from the hood to the holler.
Yep.
You don't, when you think of Kentucky, you don't think of Democratic Socialists of America. But both of these candidates came extremely close to winning. Bell lost by about 250 votes. Fenwick lost by less than 100.
Yeah, this is very tight margins here.
And so what this shows is it's not just New York City or Philadelphia, where socialists are making real challenges to local races or Seattle. It's basically every city that's experiencing any form of gentrification combined with the downward mobility of those gentrifiers who then are able to connect with the working class people who are already in the city in the sense of same interests, even if they conflict on just the geography.
It's a very interesting update. Anyway, so there we go. Two primary results from Kentucky, Colorado. Common denominator of Chuck Schumer jumping in and making something happen a little bit there. And then a Louisville update. We're going to have more Rising for you after this. I'll tell you what's on my radar.